हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ शफकनाज अंसारी फ्रॉम TYBA इकोनॉमिक्स एकेडमिक ईयर 2020 and 2021. सो इन दिस प्रेजेंटेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस ऑन द टॉपिक एनवायरमेंटल पॉलिसी ऑफ इंडिया एंड विल डू क्रिटिकल इवेल्युएशन ऑफ द सेम. सो दिस इज द क्विक रिव्यू ऑफ द प्रेजेंटेशन. आई मीन दिस आर द पॉइंट्स वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस ऑन. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, एज वी ऑल नो, हेल्दी एनवायरमेंट इज एन एब्सोल्यूट नेसेसिटी फॉर द वेलबींग ऑफ ऑल ऑर्गेनिजम्स इंक्लूडिंग मैन. All our needs, big and small, are being met by the environment. And the word environment relates to surroundings. It includes virtually everything. It can be defined as anything which may be treated as covering the physical surroundings that are common to all of us, including air, space, land, water, plants, and wildlife. So, the need for protection and conservation of the environment and sustainable use of natural resources is extremely important. So now, let's see what kind of policies Government of India has undertaken to protect its environment. And are those policies really effective in nature? So firstly, policies are meant to chart out a vision for the future. Policies are just a mere prescriptions, they are just a direction. And actually, cities and states have to adopt particular rules and regulation to implement those policies. And Indian environmental law concerns about the law and policy of India concerning the protection of the environment, measures taken to reverse climate change and achieve a zero carbon economy. Let's understand how environment as a concern came into picture in India. I mean, I am going to give you an overview of environmental policies about how it is started, from where it is started. So several environment protection legislation existed even before independence of India. However, the true thrust for putting in force a well-developed framework came only after the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment, that is in Stockholm in 1972. A total of 26 principles were chalked out during the UNCHE in 1972, which were to be adopted and followed by all participating nations. These principles became guiding principles for developing countries like India to frame environmental policies. The UNCHE was also instrumental in ensuring that global attention to environmental challenges is maintained through the decision of celebrating 5th June as World Environment Day. After the Stockholm Conference, the National Council for Environmental Policy and Planning was set up in India in 1972 itself, within the Department of Science and Technology, to establish a regulatory body to look after the environment-related issues. This council later evolved into a full-fledged Ministry of Environment and Forest, that is MOEF, in 1985. Which today is the apex administrative body in our country for regulating and ensuring environmental protection and lays down the legal and regulatory framework for the same. Today, this council is known as the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So these two particular events led to the development of lots of legislation related to environmental laws, policies, act in the following years. So as I said, after this two particular event, Government of India started passing various legislation to ensure that the quality of environment is maintained and to curb the damage caused to the environment, such as Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act of 1974, Forest Conservation Act of 1980, Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act of 1981. This act was the first umbrella act of India for the protection of its plants and animal. It was a comprehensive piece of legislation that regulates sanctuaries, national parks and zoos, among other protected locations. Its primary aim is to curb the illegal trade in wildlife. The act came into force on 19 September 1972. And this act has been enacted to provide for the prevention and control of water pollution and to maintain or restore wholesomeness of water in the country. The act came into force on 23 March 1974. This act was last amended in 2003. And this act was implemented to provide for the conservation of forest and for matter connected therewith. It was further amended in 1988. It was enacted by Parliament of India to control further deforestation of forest areas in India. The act came into force on 25th October 1980. Then this act was implemented to control the air pollution. And this was the first attempt by the Government of India to combat air pollution. The act came into force on 29th March 1981. So these were the major acts implemented to conserve the environment of our India at that time by the national government. And protecting environment also became constitutional mandate in India, because as a welfare state, India has committed to protect its environment for the protection of its citizens. The Indian Constitution contains specific provision for environmental protection. This provision is there under the chapters of Directive Principle of State Policy and Fundamental Duties. Like, according to Article 48A, says that the state shall try to protect and improve the environment. It should also endeavor to safeguard forest and wildlife of the country. And what are the fundamental duties of us? Is that every citizen of India has a fundamental duty to protect and improve the natural environment, including forest, lakes, river and wildlife, and should have compassion for living creature. It is stated in the Article 51A. So we can clearly see that various acts had been made in India at that time to ensure that the quality of environment is maintained. And we can clearly see the intention of a government were very clear to improve the environment at that time. And everything was moving very fine up till here. But there was a serious gap in those acts and laws. This were revealed by one of the greatest tragedies, a man-made disaster in central India. We all are aware of it. That is Bhopal gas tragedy that was occurred on 1984. And this Bhopal gas disaster led to increased environmental awareness and activism in India. This tragedy had played very important role to update the previous environmental laws that was prevalent in India. It is because of this disaster, new environmental act was made cautiously. And that act was the Environment Protection Act that was passed in 1986. That is after the 2 years of that Bhopal gas tragedy. So, after this Bhopal gas disaster of 1984, the Indian government realized that the existing environmental laws in India were insufficient. If we want to avoid such disaster from happening in the future, then there was a need for stronger and more powerful laws. This is why Indian government came up with the Environmental Protection Act in 1986. This act is very important because it is considered as an umbrella legislation. It fills many gaps in the earlier laws regarding protection of environment as a whole. Objective of Environment Protection Act was to provide the protection and improve of environment. Under this act, the Ministry of Environment and Forest was given overall responsibility for administrating and enforcing environmental laws and policies in India. It established the importance of integrating environmental strategies into all industrial development plans for the country. It has not always been effective. In many cases, economy has been a priority even at the cost of environment. But the Environment Protection Act is still an important legislation. It provides for coordination of activities of the various regulatory agencies. This act adopted lots of new strategies to combat the environment issue prevalent in the country at that time. For example, National Green Tribunal Court was established. It was a special court that deals exclusively with environment issue. EIA made environmental clearance mandatory for expansion or modernization of any new projects which could be hazardous. This process tells us that we should see what is the impact of any project on the environment will be. अगर कोल माइन बनाया जा रहा है तो कितना जंगल काटा जाएगा? What will happen to the people in the nearby village? Would they lose their livelihood? We should look at both the positive and negative impacts of the project. And then efforts should be made to reduce the negative impact as much as possible. And if the Environment Ministry feels that the negative impact is far too adverse, then such project should not be granted. So environmental clearance would be granted on the basis of EIA. Lots of loophole is found in EIA while implementation. We will analyze this later on. And it is also observed that later part of 1980s saw the focus shift towards sustainable development. So now let's quickly review all the major policies, laws, acts, etc. that were passed after 1985 era. You can see on the screen, these are the major acts and policies which has been adopted by our Indian government for the protection, conservation of environment. So of course, the first act that was passed after 1985 was Environment Protection Act of 1986. Then soon after it, that is after 2 years, National Forest Policy was passed. This policy was the first environmental policy document in India that indirectly recognized the linkages between environmental and social concerns in terms of community right to natural resources. Unlike the previous forest acts that privilege revenue and commercial interests, the National Forest Policy of 1988 was strikingly different. Section 4.6 of the policy highlighted the symbiotic relationship between tribals and forest and the need to evolve tribal community in the management of forests. It also emphasized that domestic requirement of firewood, fodder and minor forest produce should be the first priority of forest management, not commercial or industrial needs. In that sense, it signaled a definite change of approach and was an indication that was to be possibly come. Little later, the 1990 government order on joint forest management, that is JFM, while giving communities adjacent to reserve forest unfenced right. It was also aimed at improving the protection of forests. But unfortunately, joint forest management has remained as a policy and has not been incorporated into the Forest Act. So after the 1 year of this policy, next act came into being, that is Hazardous Waste Handling and Management Act of 1989. Then after 2 years, Public Liability Insurance Act came into being. It was enacted with the objective to provide for damages to victim of an accident which occurs as a result of handling any hazardous substance. Then after 4 years, the National Environment Tribunal Act came into being in 1995. Then National Environment Appellate Authority Act of 1997. Then Noise Pollution Act of 2000, then Protection of Plant Varieties Act of 2001, Wildlife Protection Amendment Act 2002, Recognition of Forest Right Act of 2006, then Fly Ash Utilization Policy in 2009. It was an initiative for improving the environmental performance of coal-based station through clean development mechanism. The Fly Ash Mission has made several useful recommendations for utilization of fly ash in the manufacture of cement, bricks, pavement material, floor tiles, wall panels, etc. and in agriculture, road construction, landfilling and backfilling of mine. Finding of the National Laboratories that fly ash is superior in strength and durability as compared to conventional products. The Ministry of Power is taking steps to make the use of fly ash product mandatory in road and bridge construction and construction of government building as well. At present, 63% of the fly ash is being utilized in India, but the target is 100% utilization of the fly ash. And next is the National Green Tribunal Act of 2010. It has been enacted with the objective to provide for establishment of a National Green Tribunal for effective disposal of cases relating to environment protection and conservation of forests. Then, E-Waste Management Rule of 2011 was also enacted. So these were some important environment legislations that have been passed in our country for the protection, conservation, preservation of our environment. India's current environmental policy is dominated by the country's landmark National Environmental Policy of 2006. The policy starts by acknowledging environmental degradation in India is being driven by population growth, poor resource usage choices, and poverty. The guidelines then go on to the state that environmental protections need to be integrated into development processes. It aims at mainstreaming environmental concerns into all developmental activities. It emphasizes conservation of resources and points out that the best way to aid conservation is to ensure that people dependent on resources obtain better livelihood from conservation than from degradation of the resources. It also argues that environmental degradation often leads to poverty and poor health outcome among populations. The document goes on to highlight the principle underlying the policy that emphasize the important role of human being in the sustainable development processes, the non-negotiability and incomparable value of environmental resources, right to development for all, equity in the use of environmental resources. The objective of this policy include conservation of critical environmental resources, intergenerational equity, livelihood security for the poor, intergenerational equity, integration of environmental concern in economic and social development, efficiency in environmental resource use, environmental governance, enhancement of resource for environmental conservation. And also outline a range of strategies to meet these objectives that aim at conservation of existing environmental resources through regulatory reforms, emphasize on education, information, research, capacity building, and technological innovations, and periodic evolutions of the existing policies. So up till now, we have seen the various major laws, policies, and acts that Government of India has adopted for the protection of our environment. Lots of legislations have been passed by Indian government to maintain environment and sustainability. Not only government, our judiciary also plays very important role for the protection of environment. Like, in case of any environmental related matter, any citizen can directly go to the Supreme Court and High Courts and directly filed public interest litigations, that is PIL. And these are the two major cases that have been sought out by the Supreme Court for the protection of environment. That is Kendra Dehradun versus State of Uttar Pradesh, in which dispute arose over mining in the hilly areas. But the Supreme Court, after much investigation, ordered the stopping of mining work. Second is MC Mehta versus Union of India, in which the Supreme Court issued direction toward the closing of mechanical stone crushing activities in and around Delhi, which was declared by the World Health Organization as the third most polluted city in the world. Thus, it is obvious that the courts give equal importance to both ecology and development while dealing with the cases of environmental degradation. So now we can see that India does not lack in environmental policies, and the enactments of the acts show that India had taken a definitive approach for environmental protection. And despite having a specialized court which deals with environmental cases, India still ranks high in terms of pollution around the world. Why is it so? Let's quickly analyze the effectiveness of environmental policies and laws in India. The goals of any environmental policy is to formulate several ways to protect human health, ensure viability of wildlife, preservation of historic monuments, stopping further degradation of the environment, etc. And the policy is the overall environmental intention and direction forming the backbone framework from which all the other environmental components are hung, including environmental management systems, audit, assessment, and reports. But in India, talking about human health in India, study claims poor health quality caused 1.2 million deaths each year in India. Talking about viability of wildlife, total 22 species have gone extinct in India in the past few years. 4 species of fauna and 18 species of flora, according to wildlife survey organizations. Talking about historical monuments in India, there are 3,600 plus monuments are there under Archaeological Survey of India, but only 116 monuments have entry tickets. Basic necessities are missing from many monuments in India. And talking about environment degradation, we are losing 130,000 square kilometer of forest cover every year. More than 1 crore trees were cut in the last 5 years in India. This is a Bangalore ka map. You can clearly see how vigorously the greenery has chopped out from the city. Talking about the assessment and reports, it is always observed that India often lacks in implementation of the policy. Reports of some policies are found to be fake and corrupted. We can see, ni sari policies, acts hai, but still, in a report published by Yale and Columbia University in environmental health, India ranked 178th and 145th in air and water quality respectively out of 180 countries. This shows how environmental crisis is there in India, in spite of having lots of policies, regulations. Suicides of nearly 60,000 Indian farmers linked to climate change. From north to south, 60 crore Indian. Severe water crisis. 43.4% of India is reeling under drought. Pre-monsoon rain lowest in 65 years. Niti Aayog report says 40% of Indians will have no access to drinking water by 2030. From this, we can clearly say current environmental laws and policies are not perfectly excellent. There are some loopholes in the effectiveness of these environmental policies and laws. Let's quickly analyze the effectiveness of environmental laws and policies in India through one research paper published by International Journal of Academic Research and Development. So first of all, this research paper starts with an introduction how important the environment is. Then its abstract says that, of course, the major reason behind the ineffectiveness of environmental law policies in India is lack of awareness among the people about the environment. It is very common, but it is becoming the biggest barrier. Because even though if the government provides lots of policies, if but citizens are not aware about it, then nothing is going to work well. Then it also says that even though India has sufficient environmental laws, weak enforcement and lack of funds and manpower are most often the stumbling blocks for the pollution control boards. Then here, this research paper also says that India's extensive environmental laws and policies seem to have very little effect in reducing the harmful effects of pollution. Some of the reason for it, which is mentioned here, is that the government of India is reluctant to force its own laws on air and water pollution, lest it stops developmental projects that helps create jobs and improve the economy. Although many of the environmental regulations in India on air and water pollution are similar to those of the existing standards of other industrialized countries, the lack of its enforcement has upset the global business community, as it seems to provide Indian businesses an important cost advantage. In a similar vein, environmental activist Rama Kumar states that enforcement of current laws is patchy and uneven. Effective control has been inconsistent, especially among smaller companies. Enforcement of environmental regulations might put this company out of business, creating mass unemployment, something the government of India wants to avoid. Corporations are now in a position to identify and estimate the environmental cost, benefits, investments, assets and liabilities into mainstream accounting and reporting practices for a variety of managerial decisions. This, in return, have sharpened and improved the global reporting standard on environmental issues. In India, large companies have yet to incorporate this techniques into mainstream reporting. The above discussion sums up the problem faced by the Indian government for effective enforcement of current environmental laws and safeguarding the health of its people. Apart from this, furthermore, it is somewhat ironic that while the state is reluctant to give substantial rights to communities, the corporate sector is playing an ever more important role in the management of degraded wasteland and land reform legislation reworked to enable such processes. Another example of this ideological bias is the Biodiversity Act of 2002, which is much more friendly to industry than it is to local communities. Also, the movement towards a market-based ideology of environmental management is filled with dangers. What is worrying about this ideology is not the use of market-based instrument per se, nor necessarily addressing corporate concerns, but the context in which these developments are happening. Market-based instruments are not only a tool to address environmental concerns. They need to be situated in a framework that priorities rank different group interests. In other words, it is one thing to value water to reflect its true price, but quite another thing as to who should have priority to that water. Such concerns need more attention. But policy documents are relatively silent on this concern, or stated priorities are not followed up. However, institutional or market failures are often the result of political economy as much as they are about market or institutional failures. India's forests were degraded over time less because they did not have market values and more because development priorities privilege commercial and industrial concern. One is increasingly witnessing cases where private sector companies are exploiting water resources while adjacent communities are water starved. This does not bode well for meeting the needs of rural communities. So from the above narrative, it suggests at one level that however well-intended policies and laws are, they get diluted in course of time, largely because of other developmental priorities. Apart from this, there are other various reasons for the failure of policy while implementation. One of the main reasons for this is that there is no independent regulatory body for environmental governance. It is looked after the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Due to excessive interference by government on the governance of the ministry, there is poor implementation of environmental law. There is also a lack of political will and public awareness. Almost all laws related to environment considered superiority of human over ecosystem and nature. The Comptroller and Audit General in India, in its 2011 and 12 report on performance audit of water pollution in India, say that the penalties for violation of Water Pollution and Control Act 1974 are too weak. There is lack of independence given to the central and state boards who still have to depend on the state and the central government for the appointment. The appointment is at the wish of the government. There is also a lack of funds to the Pollution Control Board, and they don't even have proper infrastructure or laboratories. There are certain laws which are not very elastic. Environmental litigation is more expensive compared to other disputes as it evolves expert testimony and technical evidences. Last but not the least, one of the major loopholes in the EIA seem to have contributed largely for the ineffectiveness of policy and degradation of environment. As I said in the beginning of the video, that after the Bhopal gas disaster of 1984, the Indian government realized that the existing and environmental laws in India were insufficient. If we want to avoid such disaster from happening in the future, then there was a need for a stronger and more powerful laws. This is why the Indian government came up with the Environmental Protection Act in 1986, and there was a new process in this act, known as Environmental Impact Assessment. The EIA process sounds all great, but in reality, its application is not that effective in India. There are lots of shortcomings in this law and in this process, and it has been grossly misused as well. Many cases have been observed where in a coal mine or a power plant has been constructed without conducting a public hearing. For example, in the case of Chhattisgarh Steel and Power Limited plant was constructed without public hearing. In some cases, the EIA reports are fake. Studies are not conducted properly. And this is exactly why disaster like Visakhapatnam gas leak happened in our country. In the story behind the fire well in the oil wells in Assam was that public hearings for the project were not conducted. The project was violating the environmental laws, and despite that, it was in operation. So you can clearly see that these laws are not being implemented in a sound manner, which lead to this kind of disaster in our country. So there is no doubt about the fact that the law needs to be made stronger, and its implementation needs to be strengthened. But it is not happening. The recent draft of EIA, which says that there is a clause of post facto clearance. This post facto clearance is extremely dangerous. Think about it. Say a coal mine is being constructed after clearing of a forest, and government will say there is no problem, continue with the operation, we will give you environmental clearance later on. In April 2020, Supreme Court had even passed judgment declaring that post facto clearance is very wrong approach. Such law should not be implemented. So EIA have to become very strict, because there are lots of negative impact of developmental project. So up until here, we understood that there are lots of laws and policies are there in India related to environment, but it is not proving to be that much effective, which is why our country is facing environmental crisis. The reason I have said, which I have just briefly explained. So now let's quickly move on to the solution and recommendation that we can adopt. So first of all, an independent regulatory body needs to be established for the environment. The reward mechanism need to be given to business organizations, etc., to detect violation and take action to address the issue. Financial subsidies, cost sharing should also be promoted. Public awareness and an increase in political will is a must. NGOs can play a very important role in this. There should be less political interference in the independent regulatory body. More decision-making power needs to be given to the boards. It is important that laws give environmental values to the society, and courts, tribunals should refrain from carrying out policy functions and must focus on making a strong environmental jurisdiction in India. To obtain a better place in future, India needs to use Environmental Performance Index, that is EPI, indicators to spot internal problems, set efficient targets, track trends, understand necessary outcomes, and identify best policy practices. What can further help the Indian government facilitates communication within stakeholders, refine policy agendas, and maximize return on environmental investment in good data and fact-based analysis. Using EPI as a powerful policy tool to meet targets of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals and pushing the nation toward a sustainable future should be the key agenda. Comparative perspective and detailed overview of this year's EPI will definitely assist India in understanding its environmental progress and refine policy choices. Apart from this, some general solution that we can adopt is that Bhutan has able to maintain strict tree laws. There, in Bhutan, you cannot chop a tree without planting more trees when you chop. We should invest in replantation technology, like big machine with claws that lift the trees up by the roots and plunk them somewhere else. So we actually have all the benefits of mature tree. This will be a good idea rather than chopping out 1,000 trees and planting 100 saplings and thinking you have done a good job, because sapling will take ages before they actually soaking up enough carbon. And last but not the least, you need the government to help enforce the targets by actually having laws, policies or incentives. So people have a reason to get there, and you need the government to also make people aware of why it is their interest to fulfill these targets. But equally, you need bottom-up unit civil society and reuse. For example, you can exhort people to say reduce vehicle usage. But unless you produce and invest in, as a government, clean, cheap, easily accessible mass public transport using renewable energy, electrified trains and metros, etc., how people will reduce their vehicle use, right? So it seemed to me that these are the sort of things we are simply not doing enough. Definitely, we know that India has faced several environmental crises and the loss is incalculable. But by following the appropriate solution, which has been just mentioned, we can definitely achieve the target and make India a sustainable developed country. Like in this situation, in this pandemic situation, what has been observed as an unintended consequences of this economic shutdown is sharp decline in pollution levels and return of the wild. And in Delhi, over the past few months, like definitely we have seen clear skies for the first time in a year. So it is hoped that this unexpected glimpse of what a sustainable earth might look like will inspire sound environmental policy required for a better future. One that is economically robust and environmentally secured. By taking account of the current scenario of India, it's become essential that India's authority should strive to achieve a society where ideal and reality legislation and implementation should correlate. When authority is managed to fulfill their role, it enables corporation to better contribute to society in a positive way. Without active involvement of common people, it is indeed difficult for the authority to devise and proper implement the environment policy. Hence, individual initiatives are of paramount importance. The bottom line is that we must have individuals of integrity with a strong value base and deep commitment if laws are to be effectively implemented. What is the use of a fine house if you haven't got a tolerable planet to put it on? So now we came to an end of this video. I hope I have given my best to explain the topic in simple, at the same time very detailed. Thank you.